Hello, this is Alan Berkowitz. I'm chair of Dechert's U.S. Labor Group, and I'm joined with three of my colleagues from our labor group today, Ian Downs, Rihanna DiClemente, and Jeffrey Rubin. Before we start, I'm supposed to read a CLE announcement for those individuals who are seeking CLE credit. This webinar has been approved for CLE credit in California, Connecticut, Illinois, New Jersey, and New York. If you would like to receive CLE credit, please print the affirmation form sent to you. You can note the code when it is read later in the program, about three quarters of the way through the program. It'll be read. A form should be returned to the email address indicated at the bottom of the form. So thank you for joining. We're going to be focusing today on arbitration agreements in the investment management industry. In terms of the agenda, I'm going to talk briefly about the pros and cons of use of employee arbitration agreements. Ian Downs is going to talk about an overview of the law governing agreements. Rihanna DiClemente is going to talk about recent developments in enforcement. And finally, Jeff Rubin is going to talk about best practices for drafting and implementing programs. In terms of the pros and cons, there is no doubt that there's been a tremendous widespread increase in the use of arbitration agreements, not only in executive employment agreements, but also in standalone programs that are in handbooks and separate programs that purport to bind the entire organization. The last decade has seen steady increase in the use. One study that was done in 2017 probably contains the best data that I've seen on the prevalence of the agreements. And under that survey, it found that 56% private sector non-union workers, about 60 million employees altogether, are now covered by arbitration agreements. Of course, in the unionized sector, it's probably 99% arbitration agreements and collective bargaining agreements. And among companies with 1,000 or more employees, there's 65.1% usage. A lot of this has been driven by the legal landscape that we're going to talk about today. There's been a steady stream of U.S. Supreme Court cases going back to 1991 have allowed and favored the use of arbitration agreements and have permitted arbitration of statutory claims, wage and hour claims, discrimination claims, and most recently, which Rihanna will talk about, last year the Supreme Court's decision in Epic Systems removed one of the last major barriers to the use of arbitration agreements by upholding so-called class action waivers, which allow employers to put into their arbitration program the requirement that the arbitration be done on an individual basis only, not on a collective or class action basis. However, there are recent headwinds that we're also going to talk about today that have at least caused some employers to think further about the use of arbitration agreements. That'll be something we'll talk about in the program. In terms of the pros of arbitration agreements, probably the number one item is that arbitration allows for a confidential resolution of employment disputes, and many of those disputes involve factual patterns that are embarrassing, involve unfavorable publicity to employers, and employers naturally would prefer to keep that sort of information private. And the arbitration system is private. Obviously, the court system, everything is publicly filed, and anybody can get copies of the pleadings, including the media. Particularly in the asset management context, confidentiality, I think, has great concerns for employers. Two recent examples, we had a client that there was a portfolio manager who did not have an arbitration agreement, brought a federal claim alleging discrimination, and that caused tremendous disconcert amongst the investors in the portfolio, put a lot of pressure on the employer. Investors were wondering how would this suit affect the portfolio manager's ability to manage, how would it affect his relations with others at the employer, and it wound up giving the manager great leverage in negotiating a very favorable settlement. On the other hand, we recently handled a matter for a head of investor relations at a asset management company. That individual did have binding arbitration in her employment agreement. She had a sex harassment equal pay claim If she was permitted to bring that in the court system, that would have caused tremendous problems with the entire investor community and that asset manager. However, that matter did play out in arbitration, private confidential arbitration. The leverage kind of shifted in favor of the employer in that case, leading to a favorable settlement. Probably the next biggest item for as a pro is class action avoidance. And I mentioned the Epic Systems case, but I'm sure you've all seen that there's been a widespread increase in class action cases filed against employers. Many of that's in the wage and hour area, but also some of it's in the employment discrimination area. And allowing you, after Epic Systems, you can put in class action waivers into your agreements, and that can be a defense to class actions and can move the class action back into individual arbitration. That's been a major factor in favor of arbitration agreements. Some of the other factors I'll mention, lesser discovery in this court system, federal and state court. Plaintiffs often use discovery as a weapon, as a tool, to force employers to settle cases. Employers know how expensive discovery is going to be in the court system. In arbitration, there is some discovery, particularly document discovery, but rarely are there interrogatories, and if there are depositions, they are usually quite limited. So that takes away, you know, one of the tools that plaintiffs have to force employers to settle, realize the cost of defense of the involving discovery, which also ties into the next point, which is lesser overall expense. Part of that is lesser discovery. Part of that is in the court system, there's all kinds of court filing requirements that the system imposes, discovery schedules, motions, pretrial filings, and much of that is lessened in the arbitration context. It can lead to an overall lesser expense. The next pro is controlled over timing. In arbitration, the parties are hiring the arbitrator. The arbitrator works kind of cooperatively with the parties to set a schedule for the case. The schedule is usually at the convenience of the parties and the witnesses in the case, whereas in the court system, you're totally at the mercy of the judge. The system tells you when to appear. Some of the dockets are fast, some of the doctors are slow, but you don't have any control over it. In arbitration, you do have control. And oftentimes, the arbitration process will lead to a faster overall resolution. And finally, in terms of pros, there are no jury trials in arbitration. And therefore, many employers feel that there's less of a chance of runaway verdicts, high compensatory awards, high punitive damages. Many employers feel that changes the valuation of the case more in their favor, and our experience has been that as well. There's been many cases where fought with the plaintiff's firms about whether there is arbitration or not and whether our agreement is enforceable. We're able to persuade them that the case is going to be arbitrated. That affects the value of the case, and we're also often able to achieve a much lesser settlement prospect that there won't be a jury trial. In terms of cons, probably the number one con is that there's much less likelihood that you're going to be able to get out of the case without going through a full-blown hearing. Although it is possible to file motions to dismiss and motions for summary judgment, the odds of them being granted are quite slim, and most arbitrators will conclude that the employee plaintiff has the right to a hearing and has the right to have their day, present evidence, and you're unlikely to get out of the case unless you settle it without going through the hearing process. Second con to consider is that whoever you pick as the arbitrator, you should choose wisely, because you're highly likely to be stuck with whatever the outcome of the arbitration award is. The court review of arbitration awards is extremely limited. The grounds under the Federal Arbitration Act are very limited, and most courts, you know, just take the viewpoint that, look, you pick the arbitration system as a way of resolving disputes, pick the arbitrator. If you don't like the outcome, basically it's too bad. So there is that negative. Third, employee morale and recruitment. This has really been in the news recently, in the last year or two, and we're going to talk about this in more detail later, but as a result of the #MeToo movement, particularly. There's been a lot of issues raised about employee morale and recruitment with companies that have arbitration agreements. Employees are questioning more and more the fairness of whether they should be subject to arbitration agreements. We've seen that, particularly in the technology industry, which we'll talk about later, some of the companies that had arbitration agreements are starting to back away from that under pressure from their workforce, under pressure in recruitment and hiring. And in the legal industry itself, there's been a whole movement of law students that was driven by Harvard, has been encouraging law students not to join law firms that have mandatory arbitration programs. A lot of law firms have backed away from that as a result of this pressure. So we've seen more and more pressure, I think, all as an adjunct or offshoot of the Hash Me Too movement. Two other cons that I'll just mention briefly. One is that some of the plaintiffs' firms, particularly in the wage and hour area, have reacted to the class action waiver by filing hundreds of individual arbitration cases, kind of taking the position to employers, look, you asked for this class action waiver, would have normally brought this case as a class, now we can't, we're gonna file hundreds of individual cases, which can be very expensive for you, almost like the wage and hour equivalent of a mass tort scenario. So there is that potential con. And the final con I'll mention is that in arbitration, you always worry that the arbitrator is gonna try to do something for everybody and come up with a split ruling, mainly because the arbitrators do want to get hired again in the future by other employers, other employees, and if they get tainted with being too one-sided in their point of view, they may not get hired again next time around. So with that, I'll turn it over to Ian Downs.
Thank you, Alan. As Alan mentioned, there has been a tremendous proliferation of cases deciding various issues relating to arbitration agreements. And that is because an entire body of law concerning the interpretation and enforceability of arbitration agreements has arisen. So what I'm going to talk about now is the general framework that applies in evaluating whether arbitration agreements will be enforced, how they will be interpreted, and the types of disputes that that are and are not subject to those two arbitration agreements. So the starting point for the analysis is the Federal Arbitration Act, the FAA. The FAA, as the Supreme Court and numerous federal courts have consistently stated, reflects a strong federal policy in favor of the enforcement of arbitration agreements for the reasons many of the reasons that Alan mentioned, the expediency, the generally lower cost, and the ability to, quite frankly, reduce the workloads on the courts from having to decide each case. The FAA generally states that arbitration agreements are valid, irrevocable, and enforceable except on the basis, or except as such grounds as exist at law or in equity for the revocation of any contract. The FAA applies very broadly to any agreement evidencing a transaction involving commerce, so it applies to the vast majority of arbitration agreements. There are some statutory exceptions, one of which was addressed in January of this year by the Supreme Court in New Prime versus Oliveira, which dealt with one of the major exceptions, which is contracts for employees involved in interstate commerce, notably truck drivers. The general principle with the FAA, and this comes from the Supreme Court's decision several years ago at this point in AT&T Mobility versus Concepcion, which was really a watershed case in the application of federal law to arbitration agreements. What the court said there was that arbitration agreements have to be considered on equal footing with other contracts, which basically means there can be no special rules governing the enforceability of arbitration contracts. The Concepcion case dealt with a rule that had developed in California concerning the invalidation of class action waivers in arbitration agreements, and the court said that's not permissible. You cannot develop a doctrine that says that a particular clause is unenforceable only in the context of arbitration agreements. So that has really gone a long way to the enforcement of arbitration agreements as they are written. As Alan mentioned, the Gilmer case from 1991 confirmed that statutory claims, whether they be claims for discrimination or claims for wage and hour or any other types of statutory claims, are subject generally to mandatory arbitration unless Congress has clearly indicated otherwise, which it occasionally does. One notable exception is that under the Sarbanes-Oxley Act, whistleblower retaliation claims cannot be required to be arbitrated, so there are instances where Congress has acted. As we'll talk about in a bit, Rhiannon will speak about states have jumped into the fray to try to deal with this, to deal with arbitration agreements, but the FAA has a very broad preemptive effect, so the extent to which states are able to act in this area is very much up in the air. So the threshold issue that will be decided in virtually each case is whether a particular dispute, whether a valid arbitration agreement exists, and whether a particular dispute is subject to that agreement. Generally, following the FAA's prescription, the questions concerning the validity of arbitration agreements and concerning the scope is determined by state contract law. As Jeff will talk about, issues like assent, whether the parties have in fact agreed to arbitrate a particular dispute, and in particular, when you're dealing with arbitration programs that are rolled out generally to employees, have the employees knowingly signed on to that program? That's all something that's ripe for determination and often is the subject of disputes. Similarly, the question of mutuality, of the illusory nature of a contract comes up. Employers, as part of their programs, understandably want to retain the ability to modify or even terminate that program. But to the extent that an employer controls that too much so that they're essentially not agreeing to arbitrate anything if they don't feel like it, that's going to be a basis for invalidation of an arbitration agreement. And then the final item here, unconscionability, we'll talk about a little later, but that's a huge battleground in terms of arbitration agreements. So at the threshold, one of the questions that is addressed or that has to be addressed and that an employer rolling out an arbitration program or adopting an arbitration agreement with its executives or asset managers has to consider is, who decides whether a particular question is going to be the subject of arbitration? Under the FAA, which states that the federal courts can send cases to arbitration upon being satisfied that a dispute is arbitrable, generally presumes that that issue, that threshold gateway issue, will be decided by the court unless the parties clearly and unmistakably delegate the authority to decide that to the arbitrator. Courts have, however, been finding that delegation fairly frequently. One of the most common ways that a delegation to an arbitrator is found is where an agreement incorporates the rules of a third-party arbitration association, like the American Arbitration Association or JAMS, Judicial Arbitration and Mediation Services, two of the largest third-party arbitrators. Their rules generally give their arbitrators the right to decide if a dispute should be arbitrated, and courts typically will find that incorporation of those rules without some language to the contrary does constitute a clear and unmistakable waiver. So in deciding these issues as an employer, as you formulate an arbitration policy, you really need to consider that issue. In particular, when we're talking about class action waivers, do we want an arbitrator who has an interest in retaining a dispute that they're getting paid to decide, do we want them deciding whether or not arbitration, class arbitration is permitted? That's something you need to consider. I think most employers would probably say that's something they'd rather have a judge decide. In the Henry Schein case versus Archer and White Sales decided back in January of this year, The court made very clear the extent to which it is going to defer to arbitration on arbitrability issues. In that case, it dealt with a antitrust suit where there was a clear carve-out in the arbitration agreement for claims for injunctive relief. And the lower courts had both said that even though arbitrability is going to be decided by the arbitrator, any argument that this case should be in arbitration was wholly groundless. The contract was so clear that there could be no basis to argue that it should be arbitrated. And the court said under those circumstances, the lower court said under those circumstances, the court can decide that issue. The Supreme Court unanimously through Justice Gorsuch said no. They said even that clear issue, even the question, even where it's wholly groundless that there should be some argument to be an arbitration, the court has to defer to the terms of the arbitration agreement and let the arbitrator decide that, even though in all likelihood the case is going to be right back in court. So in the Gilmer case, which we mentioned earlier, the Supreme Court acknowledged that statutory claims can be brought in arbitration, can be compelled to arbitration. However, in order to do so, there needs to be the ability for an employee to effectively vindicate his or her rights under the statute. And that creates a set of rules surrounding what an arbitration agreement or arbitration program must do in order to allow for mandatory arbitration of statutory claims. In particular, the agreement must preserve all substantive statutory rights, including the right to recover all damages and all types and amounts of damages, and it must preserve the ability of the employee to recover fees to the extent that's permitted by statute. Courts allow some greater degree of leeway when it comes to imposing procedural limitations on the arbitration process, recognizing the significant advantages of arbitration in terms of cost savings and efficiency. Employers can incorporate reasonable limitations on the time for bringing arbitration claims, and impose limitations on the discovery process as long as the employee is afforded a fair opportunity to present their claims. So employers can work to try to make the already somewhat more expedient arbitration process even more expedient through discovery limitations. So the final issue here that I'll touch on is the issue of unconscionability. In many ways, really where the battles are fought in terms of individual arbitration agreements, whether or not they will be enforced. In the AT&T Mobility versus Concepcion case, the court announced that a court may not rely on the uniqueness of an agreement to arbitrate as a basis for finding that enforcement would be unconscionable. So there needs to be generally applicable principles of unconscionability under state law applied to arbitration agreements in generally the same ways they're applied to other agreements. Typically, to find that an agreement is unconscionable, there must be both quote-unquote procedural unconscionability and substantive unconscionability. Both of these typically must be present in some degree. States generally apply a sliding scale so that to the extent you have an agreement that is more procedurally unconscionable, the lesser degree of substantive unconscionability required before that agreement will be set aside. Procedural unconscionability, this deals with the circumstances of the formation of the arbitration agreement. Generally, was there a lack of a meaningful choice in the acceptance of the arbitration agreement on the part of the employee? Obviously, where you're rolling something out to employees more broadly, or you're dealing with employees who are not executives, not highly compensated employees, not sophisticated necessarily, this is something that courts look at fairly closely. They look at the question of oppression and unfair surprise. Did the employees really know that they were signing on to this? Were they forced to sign the arbitration agreements? In most cases, they are. In most cases, employers say this is a condition of your employment, courts have to take that into account. And how they do that differs by state. California, which I don't think anybody is going to be surprised to hear, is incredibly employee-friendly as they evaluate these issues. They find that there is essentially an inherent level of procedural unconscionability to any agreement that is a take-it-or-leave-it agreement. Anything that is offered and given to employees as a condition of employment, there's a level of procedural unconscionability where that's rolled out to rank-and-file employees. The issue of substantive unconscionability deals with whether or not the terms of the agreement itself are unreasonably favorable to the employer. The question of does the agreement alter the rights and remedies available to an employee, courts are going to look at those and decide using various standards whether or not an agreement is substantively unconscionable. It looks at issues like mutuality, bilaterality, which is particularly a focus in California. Is an employer agreeing to be bound by this agreement with respect to claims that it itself might assert? Typically, most agreements have carve-outs for claims for injunctive relief, most notably with respect to the enforcement of restrictive covenants like non-competes and non-solicitation provisions. The extent to which that carve-out will be looked at by courts varies by jurisdiction, and California courts, again, in particular, look at that question and say, is an employer really eliminating the arbitration obligation as to those claims that it's are most likely to be asserted by the employer? If so, they will look at that skeptically. Fee shifting, cost sharing, the question of who pays for arbitration, the cost of arbitration, not to harp on California, but in California, that type of thing where an employee is required to share the cost of the arbitrator, that is by definition substantively unconscionable. Other states will look more carefully at the specifics, at the who is the employee that's involved. In New York, for instance, they will question, does the employee have the means to pay for the costs, and does the requirement that the employee bear a portion of the costs frustrate the ability of the employee to bring claims? So this is essentially a balancing analysis that that courts will undertake. And then once they look at an agreement, if they find there are provisions that are unconscionable, the question of what they will do comes up. Some courts will sever those provisions, essentially say we're just not going to enforce those provisions. But on the other hand, there are courts that will say, look, if you have an agreement that is unconscionable and has too many unconscionable provisions, that's going to be unenforceable altogether. So it's a careful consideration that employers have to undertake deciding how to implement a provision. I think I will now turn it over to Rhiannon, who's going to address some of the numerous cases that have come up through the courts recently.
Hello. So as Ian said, I'm going to talk about recent legal developments in the area of mandatory arbitration agreements. And I'm going to start out with the recent Supreme Court case, Epic Systems. And as Alan noted in the beginning of the presentation, over the last few years, employers have been increasingly adopting mandatory arbitration policies that include class action waivers. These waivers require employees to bring their employment claims in individual arbitration hearings and prohibit class action litigation. As a result of this practice, such waivers have been the focus of many legal challenges. As background, in a case called D.R. Horton, the National Labor Relations Board ruled that requiring employees to sign a class action waiver is a violation of Section 7 of the National Labor Relations Act. Generally, the National Labor Relations Act gives employees the right to self-organize and bargain collectively and to engage in other activities for the purpose of collective bargaining. In D.R. Horton, the board held that the enforcement of class action waivers unlawfully restricts workers' rights to engage in concerted activity for the mutual aid and protection under the National Labor Relations Act. At the federal level, however, cases involving class action waivers have resulted in a circuit split. On one hand, some federal appellate courts adopted the board's position, finding that class action waivers were contrary to the NLRA and that the NLRA supersedes the Federal Arbitration Act. On the other hand, other federal courts concluded that class action waivers were not a violation of the NLRA and that they were permissible. Eventually, this issue made it all the way up to the Supreme Court in 2018 in Epic Systems Corp. v. Lewis, which was a consolidation of three federal appellate court cases. In a 5-4 decision, the Supreme Court held that under the Federal Arbitration Act, individual arbitration agreements and employment contracts are enforceable, that an employee's right to bring a class action is not considered concerted activity warranting protection under the National Labor Relations Act. Essentially, the Supreme Court affirmed an employer's right to require that employment disputes be brought on an individual basis rather than as a class action. The Supreme Court noted in its decision that by passing the Federal Arbitration Act, Congress intended a liberal federal policy favoring arbitration, and pointed out that the National Labor Relations Act does not mention class or collective action procedures and cannot be read to displace the Federal Arbitration Act. While this was seen as kind of the Supreme Court's decision was seen as kind of opening the door for arbitration in a variety of disputes, the ruling, however, has had some unintended consequences. As Alan mentioned, one such risk is that of mass individual arbitration filings. A recent example of this was in August 2018, when over 12,000 Uber drivers filed for arbitration, arguing that they were misclassified as independent contractors and should be employees. While this argument has generally failed in court, that did not preclude the drivers from arbitrating those claims. Considering the required $1,500 arbitration filing fee, the cost to Uber to initiate all of the proceedings fee would total almost $19 million. Further, each arbitration would likely run tens of thousands of dollars. Similar mass arbitration campaigns are being waged with other employers as well, including Chipotle, Lyft, and Buffalo Wild Wings. This tactic of mass arbitration may give employees an upper hand in settling disputes and give employers pause when considering whether to include class action waivers. Also, as Alan mentioned, another recent development in the area of mandatory arbitration is the effects of the Me Too movement. I'm sure you've all heard about Me Too, and as Ian noted, these developments have largely arisen at the state level, where in light of the Me Too movement, state legislatures have taken steps to ban private resolution of sexual harassment claims. The state of New York is at the vanguard of these efforts. Its 2018-2019 budget prohibits certain contractual clauses requiring arbitration of sexual harassment claims, as well as other things. The arbitration prohibition in the New York law is poorly worded, however, and it faces substantial uncertainty in the light of the broad federal preemption of state laws prescribing arbitration. In fact, the New York legislature even included a savings provision in its new law, rendering the arbitration prohibition inapplicable where it would be inconsistent with federal law. Courts are likely to cite this clause in refusing to bar mandatory arbitration provisions of this kind, typically contained in employment agreements in the investment management space. Laws similar to that in New York have been passed in Washington, Maryland, and Vermont. And comparable legislation has been introduced in several other states, such as California and New Jersey. In California, a similar bill was passed, but was actually vetoed by Governor Brown, who noted concerns about the issue of federal preemption. However, the same bill has been reintroduced and will likely go before the newly elected Governor Newsom. In New Jersey, an even broader bill has been introduced, under which prospective waivers of rights and remedies related to claims of discrimination, retaliation, or harassment contained in employment contracts would be unenforceable. The proposed New Jersey bill would prohibit employers from requiring employees to sign mandatory arbitration agreements to the extent that the agreements encompass claims of discrimination, retaliation, or harassment. As we noted, these state laws will likely be subject to legal challenges, but in the meantime, employers must decide whether or not to include claims of sexual harassment in mandatory arbitration agreements in these states. At the federal level, it's also worth noting that Congress is considering similar proposals. For example, the Ending Force Arbitration of Sexual Harassment Act was recently introduced. This act mirrors similar state laws in that it seeks to prohibit the use of mandatory arbitration of sexual harassment claims. Another recently introduced bill, called the Forced Arbitration and Justice Repeal Act, or the FAIR Act, is even broader, and it seeks to ban mandatory arbitration altogether in employment and consumer agreements. Moreover, the Me Too movement has not only emboldened legislatures, but also employees who are increasingly putting pressure on their employers to get rid of mandatory arbitration policies. In November 2018, for example, about 20,000 Google employees made their case against mandatory arbitration in a very public way when they decided to walk off the job in protest of the company's arbitration policy. The policy required employees to bring all claims for sexual harassment in arbitration. In response to these protests, Google waived the policy with respect to sexual harassment claims only. The employees, however, didn't back down. They continued to press the company to abandon the arbitration policy for every employment-related claim. Google eventually acquiesced. In February 2019, Google announced not only that it would end mandatory arbitration altogether, but that it would no longer require agreements that deny employees the right to bring class actions against the company. Since that time, Facebook, Airbnb, and eBay have followed suit by modifying their arbitration policies to allow employees to bring claims for sexual misconduct and harassment in court. In the face of these developments, companies need to consider whether to compel their employees to submit all employment claims, including sexual harassment claims, to arbitration. Finally, as Ian noted, state courts are regularly considering the enforceability of arbitration agreements under state unconscionability principles. So employers need to keep up to date on recent state law developments in this area. One issue that frequently comes up is the issue of cost shifting. For example, several recent judicial decisions have considered the validity of loser pays and cost shifting clauses in arbitration agreements. An employer should be aware that courts have imposed significant limits on the enforceability of cost sharing provisions in arbitration agreements. And the most compelling arguments have invoked unconscionability and overriding public policy considerations. But even where courts have rejected those arguments, their decisions reveal how to successfully attack loser pays and cost-shifting clauses that may be subject to severance before arbitration even begins. For example, in a Tenth Circuit case called Nesbitt v. FCNH, the Tenth Circuit struck down an arbitration agreement that provided that each party would pay its own costs for attorneys and the arbitrator. The case actually involved a massage therapy school student who brought a wage claim and was forced to arbitrate her claim. In the case, the Tenth Circuit found that the agreement was unclear as to whether the cost-splitting provision could be overridden if the student won the case, such that if the student won, the arbitrator could award her her attorney's fees as well as the arbitrator's fees. The court found that the agreement left the student unsure as to whether she would be entitled to fee reductions or reimbursements, even if she won the case, which would in effect deter her from even seeking arbitration in the first place. The court found that the arbitration provision failed to provide for an effective and accessible alternative forum to court, and notably because the agreement had no severability clause to protect its validity, even if parts of the agreement were declared invalid, the court said it had no choice but to invalidate the entire arbitration agreement. So this case gives pause to think not only about cost-shifting provisions, but also about severability and whether that provision is included in the arbitration agreement. The Tenth Circuit decision in Nesbitt has become known as the effective vindication exception, and has been applied by subsequent courts to determine whether a cost-sharing provision would deter an employee from pursuing arbitration. Another issue that often comes up in the state courts is that of confidentiality. In a very recent California case after Epic Systems called Ramos v. Superior Court of San Francisco County, the California Appellate Court struck down an agreement on unconscionability grounds, and the agreement included broad confidentiality language that essentially made all aspects of the arbitration confidential. The California Appellate Court held that the clause requiring confidentiality precluded Ramos from engaging in discovery that could be helpful to her case. The court noted that Ramos would violate this clause if she attempted to informally contact or interview any witnesses outside of the formal discovery process. The court went on to say that requiring discrimination cases to be kept secret unreasonably favors the employer and discourages plaintiffs from filing claims in arbitration. The court held that the confidentiality provision, along with several other provisions, including a cost-shifting provision, rendered the agreement unconscionable under California law. This is just one example arising in California, where there's, of course, a lot of litigation over the enforceability of arbitration agreements. But employers should keep track of these developments in various states as they all apply different rules as to whether an agreement's enforceable. Finally, for those employers in California, they should keep an eye on the intersection of arbitration and the Private Attorney General Act, or PAGA. The PAGA statute allows employees essentially to step in the shoes of the state and collect civil penalties for labor and employment violations. PAGA claims, while not class actions, can be brought on a representative basis. In a recent unpublished California appellate case, however, the court held that employment agreements that compel the waiver of representative claims under PAGA are invalid because they're against the public policy of California and thus unenforceable in California. The court in that case found that the Federal Arbitration Act does not preempt state law rules that are applicable to PAGA because the FAA aims to ensure an efficient forum for the resolution of private disputes. The difference here is that a PAGA action is a dispute between an employer and the state agency. Even though the action is being brought by the employee, it's still on behalf of the state agency. So these are just kind of some recent developments. But again, employers should keep track of the developments at the state level when thinking about how to draft their employment arbitration provisions. And Jeff next will discuss best practices in drafting enforceable arbitration agreements.
Thank you, Rhiannon, and good afternoon, everyone. Before I talk about the best practices for drafting and implementing your arbitration programs, for those of you requesting CLE credit, please note the following code on your affirmation form, ARB313. Again, the code for those requesting CLE credit is ARB313. So now you have some of the background as far as the general legal principles to be aware of and some of the history regarding arbitration development in case law. So now it's time to actually draft the arbitration program. Here is my list of what I would say are the essential elements when you're actually drafting the policy or program. First of all, you want mutuality. Mutuality in many cases will serve as the consideration for the arbitration agreement unless you are implementing it in connection with a promotion or an increase or at the inception of employment. The employer's promise to arbitrate can serve as a consideration for the employee's same promise. In addition, if you don't have mutuality, even if you otherwise have consideration, it really can increase the likelihood that it's going to be found to be unconscionable and therefore unenforceable. You want to make sure that the arbitration agreement or program talks about what it actually covers, its scope. And that's important as far as the term type of claims that are going to be covered. So generally, you want it to be very broad. All employment-related disputes is how many are phrased. But you do want to carve out certain types of claims. As was mentioned earlier in the program, one of the most common types of claims that employers carve out are claims for restrictive covenants, the reason being that usually the most important type of relief in those cases for an employer is really the ability to get injunction relief. And there, you're much better off trying to get that from a court for a variety of reasons. And once you go through that whole process in court, in many cases, you don't want to have to repeat the whole process in arbitration. So many employers will just completely carve out claims regarding restrictive covenants. Also, you'll see many times claims being carved out for benefits. A lot of times the benefit plan documents themselves will have their own dispute resolution procedures, and in many cases it's more favorable to hear what's under the program than going through arbitration. You also want to make sure that you're drafting the program or policy to include individuals and entities associated with the employing entity. Many of the employment laws, employees can sue not only the employer, but they can sue related entities who may be involved, or they can even sue individual managers or other employees if they were involved in the relevant decisions. And so you want the arbitration agreement to be broad enough to make it clear that any of those sorts of claims are going to be subject to arbitration, and you don't get into an argument as to whether certain claims against certain individuals have to proceed in arbitration, whereas others have to proceed in court, and then you wind up on a two-track system litigating the same. You want to make sure that the rules are incorporated, and this is an easy way to keep your arbitration agreement relatively short by just specifying which rules will govern, because those rules themselves often have a lot of the key elements that you will need, and that will show that there was actually an agreement as to most essential elements. The two most common rules by far that employers use are the ones that were mentioned earlier by the AAA and by JAMS. They are not necessarily interchangeable. The rules do differ. They are similar in many respects. They do have differences, and you should consider those differences when you're deciding which set of rules to govern. Much of that will depend on where you're actually located. I've spoken to many practitioners who claim that in certain areas of the country, the panel of arbitrators that you can choose from is much better from one group than from the other, so that often drives decision in those locations. But you should also be considerate that there are variances in things like discovery. The AAA rules, for example, leave discovery largely up to the arbitrator, so you're not exactly sure what you're going to get, whereas the JAMS rules do have provisions in there telling employees and employers what types of discovery they will get. So there are things like informal exchange of information, and all parties automatically get at least one deposition. You want to make sure that there is an explicit court and a jury waiver, just like if you were drafting any other type of employment agreement. You probably will want that language to be separate from the other agreement, either in all caps or boldface type or underlined or something to make it stand out to the employee, because courts recently are very concerned and they look closely to see whether or not an employee realizes that by signing this arbitration agreement, they are giving up their right to proceed in court and with the jury. You should include a statement that any decision of the arbitrator can be enforced by court. Without that, you may have difficulty getting the arbitration decision actually enforced. As we mentioned earlier, it's key that you have a severability clause, because it's a bit of a moving target as far as what will and will not consider permissible when it comes to arbitration. And so an agreement that you draft today, a court might decide that one of those provisions is no longer going to pass muster in a year or 2 years from now. So you want to have a severability clause in there to make it clear that a court or an arbitrator can sever whatever it finds to be unenforceable, and it doesn't destroy the otherwise enforceable arbitration agreement. And finally, you should consider including a class action waiver. As we mentioned, this has really been beneficial to employees, or to employers rather, trying to avoid class actions. But I have this asterisk here basically for the reasons that we discussed earlier. Some plaintiffs' attorneys are becoming increasingly wily about this, and they're saying, you want arbitration, we are going to make sure you get it. And they go ahead and file hundreds of duplicative arbitration actions, which really can put employers in a difficult spot and take away many of the benefits that they were originally trying to get from the arbitration agreement. So it's something to consider whether or not it makes sense for your particular organization. Now, these are the elements that I listed as essentials, but they are certainly by no means the only thing that you can choose to include in your arbitration programs or agreements. There is a lot of leeway here when it comes to drafting these agreements, and so you can include other sorts of things. For example, many employers have chosen to try to have some sort of pre-arbitration filing dispute resolution period. So often you will see in arbitration agreements a period such as 30 days where the employer and employee agree that they are going to try to resolve the dispute informally before going to arbitration. You can build in things like qualifications of the arbitrator. You may want somebody who, for example, is experienced in the investment asset industry and specify that in the agreement, which will help when it comes time to actually choose. Other things to keep in mind when you are drafting these is the potential roadblocks. Some of these we have touched on earlier. One of them, for example, is unilateral modification. Courts are very concerned if employers reserve the right pretty much unfettered to take away or eliminate, modify, or otherwise get rid of the arbitration policy or agreement. This was very common in older employment arbitration provisions, and the courts have really not liked it recently and have been striking down arbitration agreements. Now, it doesn't mean that you as the employer can reserve no rights to yourself. You can still reserve some, but there needs to be somewhat limited. So it's important to check the jurisdiction that you're in. Some of these rules vary by jurisdiction. But overall, the types of things that courts have allowed to pass muster are unilateral modification rights if they're limited as far as notice. So in many times, you must provide notice of 30 days or 60 days before the change goes into effect. You sometimes or usually will draft it so that any claims that are already pending or any claims that have arisen at the time that you make the change are excluded from the change, so it's really only operating prospectively. The sharing of fees and costs is another big one. As Ian mentioned, that can really sink the arbitration agreement. That, again, varies by jurisdiction. If you want to try to pass along some of the arbitration costs that are unique to arbitration, certainly do not do it in a program that you are rolling out to everyone at the firm. You want to limit it to high-level people, those who are highly compensated and who can afford to bear some of that cost. And usually you will still want the arbitrator to retain some ability to change the allocation if the arbitrator deems necessary. Confidentiality. This is another one where agreements used to be drafted very broadly and basically say you cannot discuss anything about the arbitration. Courts have not liked that, and they have started to say that if you really can't discuss anything about the arbitration, including its existence, it hampers an employee's ability to prepare for the arbitration, and so they have not liked those clauses. So you need to be careful as far as how you do the confidentiality carve-out. And finally, you want to be a little bit careful of claims seeking injunctive relief. There are some claims that can be brought and you can seek injunctive relief, even though that's not what is normally sought by employees. And so usually the way you want to phrase those carve-outs is either as far as certain types of claims where injunctive relief is really what you as the employer will want, such as for restrictive covenants, or where you are seeking interim injunctive relief, so that after that you will go to arbitration for the actual underlying and underlying merits of the dispute. Before I go on, I'll just repeat that code for those of you requesting CLE credit. Again, that code was ARB313 and in case it did not come through clearly. All right, so now when it comes time to actually implementing the arbitration agreement or program, again, underline key thing, consent is required, and you are going to have to be able to show that an employee has assented to the arbitration provision. And that could affect the method by which you choose to roll it out. The most straightforward way is by an arbitration agreement. Just like any other agreement, you give it to the employee, they sign it, they return it, you have a binding agreement. Many employers have chosen not to do that, and they have tried to do it through a policy because they think it may be actually easier. And so a lot of times you will see arbitration policies included in larger documents like an employee handbook. In most jurisdictions, that is acceptable, and that can be a valid way of getting an arbitration agreement. You need to be very careful. For those of you who have an employee handbook in place, which is hopefully most of you, you will know that one of the key elements of an employee handbook is a contract disclaimer provision, basically saying that all of the policies in the handbook are not contractual in nature and do not form a contract. That is a problem if that is what you are relying on to get your agreement to arbitrate. You need to be very careful that if you are doing it that way, that you put in carve-outs to the contractual disclaimer language, making clear that the arbitration policy is actually a binding agreement. You also usually will want it to be in a conspicuous place. You're usually not going to want to bury it in the middle of a 100-page handbook. You're going to want to have it either at the very front or the very back. Some employers have chosen to deal with that issue by putting it with the employee acknowledgement of the handbook so that instead of just signing the employee acknowledgement, they are also signing the employee acknowledgement and the arbitration policy, which makes it harder for employees to argue that they weren't aware and didn't know that this was actually part of the longer handbook. You want to make sure that the employee actually has time to review the handbook. This can destroy an otherwise valid arbitration agreement. There was a case decided just within the past 2 weeks or so in California basically saying that the arbitration agreement itself was not the problem. But what had happened was the employee was brought on board. As in with any employee being brought on board, there's lots of different documents to sign. So she was given a stack of documents to sign, but she was told, we have a meeting starting in 15 minutes. So sign everything and don't be late to the meeting. So she signed, court went through about a dozen documents in about a dozen minutes, and the employee said, there's no way I could have actually read this arbitration agreement within that time frame. I didn't know what I was signing up for. It should be invalid, and the court actually agreed. So make sure you're not undermining things with your statements and actions. One of the ways I actually like to deal with this is if you're doing this as part of the hiring process, give the employee the arbitration agreement at the time of hire or at least reference in your offer letter that they will be required to sign an arbitration agreement. That really helps to eliminate the procedural unconscionability argument because one of the arguments that employees make is that they've already given up their prior job. They're now being forced to sign this arbitration agreement. They really had no choice because otherwise they were not going to have an income. It really helps to blunt that argument if you give employees the arbitration agreement ahead of time, in many cases before they have quit their previous job, or at least it takes, if they're on notice that they have to sign it, even if they don't have the document in hand, that can really help. And finally, just a note about e-sign and other electronic signatures. This is becoming an increasingly common way for employers to get employees to sign documents. If you're doing that with an arbitration agreement, you want to be especially careful. Make sure you pay attention to the difference between agreeing and acknowledging. Many times what employers have to read through are really in the form of acknowledgments, like notice of certain rights under the law. And then there's a box at the end saying, I agree that, or I acknowledge that I've received all of this information. That's not the same thing as agreeing, so make sure that it is very clear that they are actually agreeing to the arbitration agreement, including by including a specific statement that by clicking they are signing a binding arbitration agreement. You also need to be able to show that it was actually the employee who signed, so it needs to be authenticated. Certainly should be a signature block. Generally, you will want some sort of date and or time stamp and some other way to verify either through a login or through an IP address or something along those lines that it was actually the signed it. So that is my lightning round of best practices. Thank you very much for joining us. Again, for those of you seeking CLE credit, in case you didn't catch it the first two times, the code that you should note on your affirmation form is ARB313. Thank you again very much.